Pianist Isata Kanneh-Mason's celebration of Clara Schumann hit number one on the UK classical charts when it released in 2019. Now she's back with a look at 20th century American piano rep in her new album, Summertime. In this look behind the playlist, she talks about uncovering some new repertoire.
What did you particularly love about the Samuel Barber Sonata the first time you heard it?
I loved that it was such a dramatic piece. I loved that it was dramatic in a shameless way, and it was very exciting. And the music is so polyphonic and has so many different levels that I felt like I had so much to explore if I learned it.
The Barber Sonata was premiered by Vladimir Horowitz, and I read that you feel a pretty deep influence of Horowitz. What does a legacy like his mean for a young pianist like yourself today?
I think it's always important to have role models and people to aspire to and to inspire you and to look up to. And Horowitz is definitely one of those people. He's one of the greats. And I think it's just so important to see what's possible and to hear what's possible as well.
You and Samuel Coleridge Taylor share a heritage from Sierra Leone in England. And does that, as you play his music, bring a special kinship to it?
Definitely, yes. I think it's such a great connection. And I was so excited when I found it out. And that's why I wanted to include him on the album, because I love his music and relate to him as a composer as well.
Tell me about the impromptu. This is the world premiere recording of his impromptu. How did you come across a piece that had not yet been recorded?
Well, actually, my sister had played the piece, I think, in a concert. And so when I was looking for more Samuel Coleridge Taylor, she said, oh, how about this piece? And then she gave me the music because she had it. And we both looked for a recording to hear how it went and couldn't find one. That's when I realized, oh, it hasn't been recorded before. So then I was even more excited to learn it and figured out how it went just by playing it, which is the first time I've really done that.
Do you and your siblings collaborate on sort of that repertoire finding and planning process a lot?
Sometimes, actually, yeah. I mean, if it's something like important, like a competition or an album, we tend to ask each other for advice and we'll send each other pieces of music or recommend stuff.
Being the eldest of seven siblings who are all such talented musicians, did that really help the whole lockdown 2020 thing sort of run a little more smoothly for your life?
Yeah, definitely. I think we were so lucky to be in a house with lots of other people when so many people were alone. And also, I think just having people to play music with and having people to talk to and to see really kept us sane. I was, of course, very busy and noisy in a way that it hasn't been since childhood, but that was a minor side effect.
What is probably the biggest misconception people have about a family like yours with that much talent in one space?
I think the most common misconception is that we're all just born with this talent and that so many people just kind of got lucky at the same time. I think how it actually tends to work is if you have a group of people who've had similar opportunities and grown up in a similar environment and therefore have the same inspirations and interests, and then you all work hard. I think so many things are possible. So I think to say that we all have talent is not quite accurate. For me, talent is an inspiration and an initial interest, which is combined with hard work, but also opportunity. So therefore, that's why I think so many people aren't given the opportunity to be talented because they don't have the same opportunities. So we're very aware of that.
Thank you.
after this last 16 months or so, classical music is really never going to be the same. As we all sort of relearn how to navigate both concert experiences and even for a, you know, a world-known musician like you traveling the world as it is now, what are your hopes for the future, both in the next couple of years and then for like your generation of artists to sort of make your mark on the world?
Yeah, well, I hope that traveling becomes easier. I hope that the appreciation and the zest for the arts comes back full force, which I have no doubt that it will. I think what I worry about and what I hope can be sorted is the arts have lost so much money, and I hope that people who care about the arts really help to fund them, and people who don't realize their importance and value in society and give them the place that they deserve. And that's also what I hope for my generation. I hope we produce more artists and more people my age choose to take a career in the arts if that's something they enjoy, and don't shy away from it out of fear. And that there are many more young people getting into art and into classical music and kind of bring that up with us as a generation.
Your new album has, you know, classical music from the sort of late romantic time going into the contemporary period. And your family has done so much playing of pieces, things like a Bob Marley tune. You're equally comfortable in all these different eras and styles. And you brought a little musical theater in with the Gershwin this time. What is your sort of next type of music you're looking at and thinking, oh, I'd love to cross over into that?
Well, that's interesting, because next I'm actually, there's so much of the standard classical repertoire that I still don't know yet. So I kind of want to do a combination of trying all of these different things and bringing in lesser known composers as well, such as Samuel Coleridge Taylor. But I also want to play many pieces in the standard repertoire that I've loved for years, like Rachmaninoff and Beethoven. And I think it's important to do both things, because I think it's important for people who are aspiring to be musicians feel that they're not limited in any way, whether that's exploring the standard repertoire or the non-standard repertoire.
Your first album was Clara Schumann, who composed her pieces pretty young. Even though she continued her playing career throughout her life, she composed before, you know, her 30s. And so that sort of had this kinship of a young artist playing music by a young composer. And now you found these other sort of connections to these pieces in the new album. Do you specifically seek out things where you have this sort of personal life connection to the composer or the piece itself?
Well, I think what tends to draw me in first is always the music. I always have a kind of instinctive response to the music, which isn't conscious. And I think that when I finding out about the, sorry, should I start that again? Because a siren just went past and I don't know if that was a bit disruptive.
I didn't hear it at all.
Okay. Yeah, so I tend to have an instinctive response to the music and to the composer. But finding out about their life is something that comes later. So I feel that I love the music and I want to play it. I don't tend to have a conscious reason why. Then I start looking into them more. And I think you can find things in common with pretty much anyone. And of course, there are people with whom you have more in common than others. But I think if you look hard enough, you can always find commonalities. And the more life experiences you have, the more commonalities there are to have, because there's more parts of you. And so I don't see me as having things in common with certain composers a freakish coincidence. I think it's just, if you look hard enough, you can relate to them.
What are you looking forward to the most playing wise in the next few months?
I would say I'm most looking forward to playing at the proms with my family. We're all going to be playing Carnival of the Animals together, and I think that will be so much fun.
That prom is on August 29th. You can also hear Summertime, as well as all of the Kanneh-Mason family's albums, on 90.5 WUOL Classical Louisville.